But notice that's not the end of that verse. The wages of sin is death. Powerful word now. But what does that mean now? What it means, what's coming next supersedes it. It answers it. It's not that the wages of sin is death is untrue, but here's a truth that supersedes it. You see, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God. See, already I'm perking up a little bit. What? You mean there's a gift that answers the wage? The gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now, why does Paul say it that way? He's saying what we deserve is death, but instead of death, God gives us. He offers us a gift, which is eternal life. Now, which side of that do I want to live on? Which should I focus my attention on? Well, I should focus my attention on the other side. The other side of the but means it supersedes it, you see. See, I would be making a mistake if I focused on this first part, wouldn't I? I would be in error just to focus on that, because I would be ignoring a higher truth. See, if I want to walk by faith and not by sight, if I need to latch on to the truth that supersedes that negative truth. See, I want to go through life with my attention focused on God's given me a gift. We could talk about that all day. The fact that it's a gift, I didn't pay for it, I didn't earn it, I didn't deserve it. It just speaks of the goodness of the giver, and because I have received the gift. See, he gave me the gift so I wouldn't have to get the wage. He gave me the gift to supersede. You see what I'm getting at here? It has everything in the world to do with where we focus our attention. Now let's look at another one, if you don't mind. Go back to the Old Testament to Psalms 34, and if you don't want to turn to all these, Elliot will put it up here for you. Psalm 34, verse 19. What am I going to do when Elliot, when you and Anton are both at college? Are you going to train Alex to do this?
Phil's going to do it.
Phil's going to do it. All right. Somebody's going to have to do it. Psalm 34, verse 19. Here's another one. Many are the afflictions of the righteous. Stop right there. If that's the only thing we've got, the only truth we've got, that gives me a bleak outlook on life, doesn't it? Like the Apostle Paul when he said, I'm going to Jerusalem and I know trouble and afflictions waiting for me. See, if I look at this and the only truth I've got my attention on is many are the afflictions of the righteous. Talking about me, if I do well, boy, thanks for telling me that. You know, lots of trouble is what he's saying. But you see, the word but means what's coming after supersedes it. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of 2/3 of them. Oh, thank you. I said it wrong on purpose. The Lord delivers them out of some of them, but it's up to Him. You never know what He's going to do. Maybe He will, maybe He won't. Did you notice how certain this is? The Lord delivers him out of them all. Now, why is that such an important truth that after that? But see, the word but means it supersedes it. Sure, there's trouble. Sure, there's problems. Sure, there's things that come against you. But you don't have to let those things move you. See, Paul said, none of those things move me. You can say the same thing, if you will. And what you've got to do, though, is walk by faith, not by sight. Choose to look at the other side of the superseding truth that's higher. Well, we look not at the things that are seen, but the things that are not seen. And it really is your choice. You know, you have to choose to do this. Because you can spend all your time like Solomon, looking at life under the sun and saying it's all vanity and it's all emptiness. And you can get really depressed about it. But what I'm encouraging you to do is lift up your eyes a little higher and look at a truth that supersedes it. Sure, these things that are afflicting me, guess what? Paul said everything we can see is temporal, temporary. He says many are the afflictions of the righteous, and I can put that in there. It's temporary. It's temporal because it says the Lord delivers them out of them all. That's where I just choose to put my attention. Sure, I might be going through a problem, but here's what I say. I'm believing in a God who knows how to deliver me out of all of them. And he didn't just say, see, he could have, if it was his intention for you to just stew in it, sort of, and just stay there, he would have said, the Lord delivers some people out of some things, but others he just lets them have it. No, he says he delivers them out of them all. So I just choose to take that personally. How about you? He doesn't even say they need to get themselves out of it. That's what we say sometimes. Well, you got yourself into it, you can get yourself out. You know, that's what we, you know, and then sometimes that's maybe some I don't know what that is, but we say that. That almost sounds kind of vindictive in a way to say that. But see, the Lord is not vindictive. Isn't that good? He's not out to give us what's coming to us. Did we read that before? The wages of sin is death. If He wanted us to get what's coming to us, He could have done it all right. But instead of being vindictive, instead of giving us what's coming to us, instead of... See, He could have sat up in heaven and said, "You people, I can't believe you. You got yourself into this, get yourself out." He could have said that, but He's not like that. Aren't you glad? The Lord delivers him out of them all. Now notice, what am I saying to you? Why did I bring this verse up? Because that little word "but" right in the middle here means that here's a truth, all right. The word "but" means what I'm getting ready to say after the word "but" means it's greater than. It supersedes it. It's a higher truth. And this is where you should live, on this part where the Lord delivers him out of them all. Now if you choose to live on that side of it, you can say like Paul, "None of these things move me." In fact, that's my last example. Let's go back again to Acts chapter 20. Now, I didn't point this out to you at the time because I hadn't said what I just said. But now I want to point out to you how Paul used that same little preposition in this very statement we were reading. Acts chapter 20, verse 24. Well, let's back up and get the context. 22. "And now, behold, I go bound in the Spirit unto Jerusalem, not knowing the things that will befall me, except that the Holy Ghost witnesses in every city, saying, bonds and afflictions are waiting for me." I wonder if Paul had that Psalm 34 in mind. You know, "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all." Wouldn't surprise me. I think Paul knew about Psalms 34. He might have had this in mind. Maybe that's why he could say what he says next. Look how verse 24, that wonderful verse we've been focusing on. What's the first word in verse 24? But. You see, he just got through saying some things negative that he could have dwelt on, the bonds and the afflictions. And maybe he had Psalm 34, 17 in mind, 19 in mind when he said, "Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. Bonds and afflictions are waiting for me, but..." In other words, now I'm going to tell you a truth that supersedes what I just said. "But none of these things move me." I wonder if it's okay for us to say that about things in our life. Things that come along, you know, that could otherwise be discouraging. It takes a little bit of boldness. Say, "None of these things move me." It's almost kind of frightening in a way to say that. Because really, you're stepping out on faith. When you say, you know, when you look at trouble, when you look at a problem and you say, "Doesn't move me." The reality is you don't feel like that's true. Because you feel like it does move you. But by faith, because you're trusting in... Who is it that we're trusting in, by the way? I mean, can we really trust Him? I mean, is He really worthy of our trust? I wonder. I think He is. You know, what Paul says, and see, He is, but we're not always convinced. Here's another thing Paul said, Romans chapter 8, very familiar thing. He said, "What shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us?" I think Paul was fully convinced that God really was for him. And it would be good, you know, if we could be fully convinced too, because the trouble part of things are temporary. But look at what he says. "But none of these things move me." It's a good attitude to have. "Neither count I my life dear unto myself." That's another powerful truth. You know, that makes you invulnerable when you don't count your life dear to yourself. "So that I might finish my course with joy." Again, I'd rather paraphrase and say, "I'm going to enjoy my life." Jesus said, "I've come that they might have life, have and enjoy life," the Amplified said. Now, it's one thing to go through life, you know, dragging and sad and hate to face the next day. But it's another thing to say, "I'm going to go through my life with joy." And the way we can do that is to adopt this attitude that Apostle Paul recommends to us. He calls it walking by faith and not by sight. He describes it by saying, "None of these things move me. Neither count I my life dearer to myself, so that I might finish my course with joy, enjoy the course I'm on, and the ministry which I've received with the Lord Jesus to testify." Maybe this is why he had such a connection with enjoying his life. So I've got a message. It's good news. The gospel of the grace of God. Well, let's all stand up today. Jesus is my